AI algorithms can fold proteins and create stock imagery on the fly. They're able to beat humans at the most complex games that we can conjure up. Soon, AI may even help us with more difficult tasks, like understanding the female mind. So it seems like a small ask for AI to help improve the drug development process where 90% of drugs fail. Today, we're going to check in with the most promising AI drug discovery stocks out there. But first, let's divide the domain into three segments. So the first segment, and the largest, is the privately held AI drug discovery company. So one firm estimates there are around 463 AI startups working on drug discovery. I've noted some of the names here that we come across frequently and also what other experts deem companies to watch. There are also big pharma internal development efforts. The problem with this category is that this work may not be so visible. And partnerships don't mean that these efforts are being outsourced. They could just be kicking the tires. They have huge budgets. They're giants when compared to a small AI drug discovery companies. And then you have publicly traded AI drug discovery stocks. That's the topic of today's presentation. And we count at least eight names. So all I've done here is taken our tech stock catalog and filtered on the artificial intelligence column and then further drilled into AI drug discovery. And you can see notes here for each of the eight stocks listed in our catalog, along with the date that we last left these notes. I think they're all pretty much relevant. And we're going to start today by looking at leaders. And we always want to invest in leaders for any given domain. And this great quadrant by Frost and Sullivan shows companies in the upper right that have mature internal pipelines, large strategic partnerships, and they're also integrating a wet and dry lab producing novel compounds. So Exscientia and Recursion, these two firms are said to be going through a merger. And if that happens, both companies will have sufficient capital until 2027. Now, we usually don't cover mergers because sometimes they fall through and you don't want to do all that work for nothing. But I thought this was a case where it made sense to look at this in advance. We produced this piece here, Recursion and Exscientia, an AI leader emerges. One thing to note here, just you can read this article, search for it on our website, but take their NVIDIA partnership with a grain of salt. So the Recursion's built the fastest wholly owned supercomputer of any pharma company worldwide. It's 35th in terms of how fast it is. I think the one they had before was somewhere around 80th. So they've bought a lot of stuff from NVIDIA, and it's certainly the investment that NVIDIA made in Recursion was minuscule, and that makes for great press releases, right? So if these firms do merge, we want to see more late-stage progress, or even if they don't. Recursion's recent readout was underwhelming, and I've highlighted that here. This is their pipeline pre-merger, and this leading candidate here, REC994, they said improvements in either patient or physician-reported outcomes were not yet seen at the 12-month time point. So the drug may be safe and all, but if it's not helping patients, then it's not doing any good, right? So here's what the combined pipeline looks like should the merger go through. Notice that Exscientia's pipeline is all in earlier stages, so that certainly doesn't help us very much. And one of the main hangups we have around AI drug discovery companies is we want to see more later stage progress. So when you look at this great chart here by the gradient, it shows the 13.5-year cycle time it takes for a drug to go from target validation all the way to approval or commercial launch. And you can see the time it takes for each of these phases and the costs associated with them and the probability of success. So the idea is that AI can help bring drugs to market faster and give them a better chance of succeeding. Now, when we look at the combined revenues for Recursion and Exscientia, you see here on this chart, so while Recursion is seeing increasing revenues over time, Exscientia is seeing their revenues slowly decline. And they talk about having the combined company having over $20 billion of milestones before potential royalties. And what we're assuming here is that late stage milestones will generally be larger. And we're taking that from this table here on the right, which is AbCellera's own milestones broken down by where they are in the regulatory drug approval process. And As you can see, most of the money is weighted towards commercialization, as you would expect, right? You need a drug to succeed. That's the whole point of using the platform. So speaking of AbCellera, let's talk about the second company we like, Recursion being the first. And the last time we checked in with AbCellera, you see here, they had 9 molecules in the clinic, and we scratched off the 2 on top. So those were related to COVID. They're no longer applicable. And then at the bottom there, actually, this one goes away because they're selling this particular firm that they have a equity investment in. And then I've highlighted their Triani license. So these were the mouse models. If you're somebody that's followed this firm, then you'll understand what I'm talking about. But we didn't think that those ought to be that relevant, considering they were acquired rather than something that AbCellera has been working on for quite a while. Now, when you look at what they're up to today, according to their latest investor deck you see here, they talk about, 14 molecules in the clinic, and there's updates on their own molecules that they're advancing. Well, what it comes down to is that you have a $780 million company with $700 million in cash, and essentially you're getting an AI drug discovery firm for cheap. Why is that? Well, I don't know the answer to that question, but there's usually a reason for these things. It could be that the market doesn't believe that they're going to be able to fund themselves long enough to bring in significant revenues and survive without having to raise more debt or sell more shares. And one concern I had looking at their latest investor deck is, and website, is I'm not seeing a pipeline of candidates anymore. I don't know where that went. In its place, you see here two compounds that they're two molecules that they're progressing forward. First of all, we want to see internal delineated from external, because guess what? Internal drug development is a lot more expensive than having a drug that's being developed with a partner. They talk about clinical manufacturing coming in 2025. Manufacturing what exactly? I know they put a whole bunch of money into building a manufacturing facility, and there was government funding involved in that as well. In the first half of this year, they realized $17 million in revenues. Compare that to the over $8 billion in potential milestones they have coming. One wonders when those are going to start arriving and how much credibility does this platform get for the COVID success story. This is something we talked about in our last AbCellera piece. They burned $90 million in the first half of this year. They have $700 million left. So we're going to check back in a year. Again, we want to see more later stage progress for any of these firms that proves their platform, in fact, advances drugs faster and that the success rate increases as a result of using AI algorithms and all the big data that they're crunching through. So again, decreasing visibility around their clinical molecules is a concern because we can't exactly see how they're progressing. Now, a couple companies we're not interested in at all. The first is BioXcel Therapeutics. You can see here on the bottom our comments from several years ago. It's a convoluted structure. They had some fraud allegations. Just zero interest when you see something like that. And you see $26 million market cap. It's sinking into oblivion. We don't look at firms this small. The same holds true for Benevolent AI. So they have a $100 million market cap. That's really the death zone, companies that start sinking down this low. They went public via a European equivalent of a SPAC, dropped their candidate after a mid-phase flop, laying off staff. None of this bodes well. It's not a company we're interested in. And when you look at their pipeline, I thought this was interesting. They have their own internal pipeline. And when they say things like this, we're actively exploring licensing discussions and commercialization partnerships for specific assets in our pipeline. That's not good, right? Because then it just reeks of desperation. So that isn't a firm that we're interested in. Now, there are two mature platforms that we're going to look at today that really differentiate themselves from the rest. The first being Schrödinger. We happen to be holding shares in this firm. And our last piece here on the right, you see aptly titled, is Schrödinger coming under pressure from AI? Well, according to management, AI is only going to benefit them. But you can read that piece and digest the conclusions that we reached. But I think this chart is most concerning. So it shows a expected decline in revenues in 2024. And you could say, well, Perhaps that's the unpredictable drug discovery revenues tailing off for one particular year. But then when you look at software revenue growth, so that's the bread and butter of this platform, you see it's been declining every year. And just some thoughts on that. So that declining rate is our biggest concern, more so than 1 year of declining revenues. They have a steady growth of larger customers, which is reassuring, but that's being offset by smaller customers bailing for any number of reasons. The company's hesitance now to provide drug discovery revenue guidance is understandable. I think you can just think of that stuff as sort of bonuses. But software sales need to start reflecting the supposed uplift that their CEO expects to see from today's advancements in AI and biology. And that brings us to a company that was raised by our premium subscribers, so we covered it, Certara. Their business model is really two components. I've highlighted one that isn't so interesting. Well, it's in biosimulation is fascinating stuff. It really is, creating a digital twin of humans. But this tech-driven, this services, that word services is a concern because it doesn't really scale very well. Software scales well. Services, you just have to throw more bodies at it. So 63% of the revenue is coming from services. You see software on the left. Now, there's some attraction to that. I imagine they're going to be touting AI like everyone else. But to call this an AI drug discovery firm would be really pushing it. But when you look at their customer base, so look at this comment on the right, it says 90% of novel drug approvals were achieved by our customers. So does that mean that every single one of those approvals used this platform? Not really, doesn't say that, just says that these customers had drug approvals, right? You have to pay attention to the investor relations people. They try to sneak things in there like that. But this bottom statement, 38 of the top 40 biopharmaceutical companies by R&D spend are their customers. So like Schrodinger, you can sort of think, well, if everybody's your customer, then where does the upside come from? Well, you can sell adjacent products. You can improve on the product you have. Of course, that requires R&D spend. But you can read more about this in the article that we published on this company. And that brings us to one newcomer in this list, Xtalpi, or Quantum Farm. So this began trading in Hong Kong. First comment here is that the simple valuation ratio, so that's just market cap divided by annualized revenues, is just ludicrous. It's $5.9 billion market cap company. In the last half, they had revenues of $14.4 million. So you run the math on that, you get a simple valuation ratio of 205. That might be the richest in our catalog by far, at least of the firms where it makes sense to use simple valuation ratio. Now, the first comment here, I think, on calculating this stuff, you can use Hong Kong dollar and RMB, renminbi. You can use these interchangeably, just divide by seven, roughly, right? So you're going to need to do that when you go through their financials because they're all listed in either of those two currencies. Foreign listed firms are challenging to monitor, make no mistake. But when you look at their revenue growth, I thought this was rather impressive. Consistent revenue growth over time. Look at that across the top there. So read from right to left. You see how revenue is growing nice and steadily. Of course, they're also burning lots of cash. But that consistent revenue growth means that simple valuation ratio is very appropriate here. It's just that the firm is wildly overvalued based on hype, no doubt. When we look at the revenue breakdown by geography, I thought this was interesting. So half of the revenues for the first half of this year came from China, and roughly 60% of the revenues were from drug discovery solutions, 40% from intelligent automation solutions. And they say here, our customer base includes 16 of the top 20 global biotech and pharmaceutical firms. So that's interesting. But look here, when we break down the intelligent automation solutions, we see two components. They're both labeled services. So again, when we see something labeled services, that's not attractive because it implies that you need to scale that with headcount, and that won't scale very quickly. Now, we might take a closer look if their simple valuation ratio settles back down to earth. That's because this is a difficult company to navigate, and if we're not going to consider buying it, then why spend the time researching on it? So as soon as we see a more appropriate valuation, perhaps we'll spend the many hours needed to digest all of their collateral, figure it out what it is they do, and if there's an appeal in owning that stock. Now, last but not least, Relay Therapeutics. So This headline here from Fierce Biotech: Genentech sinks SHP2 pact, leaving Relay to race thinning field. And if you go back and look at our article, this was several years ago on Relay Therapeutics, we had concerns about Genentech being their only partner. We talked about how I think there was somewhere around $700 million or something like that, that in milestones lined up. Well, that just vanished. So when you look at what's left, their current pipeline, it's all very early stage. They have around $700 million in cash that's expected to last through the second half of 2026. And they just recently announced that they're going to sell more shares to raise more capital. And look, this comment on the bottom: shares of Relay soared nearly 53% on September 9th, so just a week ago, after the company announced positive interim data from the early stage study of its lead investigational candidate for breast cancer. So that positive news, it's funny how these firms will sell shares right around the time they have some positive news, right? That's a smart thing to do. Now, what are we looking for when we look at this domain of AI drug discovery stocks? Well, we want a leading platform, and that should look like a breadth of partnerships with notable big pharma names, no startups or no Ginkgo Bioworks stuff, creating your own client stuff, right? A balanced pipeline. At each stage of that pipeline should have numerous candidates, right? We want to see a factory, an AI factory that's producing successful drugs. Proven results. We want to see something that makes it to phase three, ideally something that gets commercialized with other candidates not far behind. Sure, we'll have to pay a little bit of premium when this happens because there'll be hype around it, but who cares? We'd rather see that traction than we would watch a company sink into oblivion because their platform doesn't actually work as advertised, and that's a concern. Focus on the platform, not the product. So you can have internally funded and developed candidates. That's a bonus. But when you see a firm that says, well, we're taking our candidates in-house and that's a good thing. No, it's not. It's because your pharma partner bailed. Now you're left wondering what to do with a drug that you need to develop, which is going to cost a lot of money. And failures don't prove the concept. So I noted this article from Vile that talked about this candidate from Exscientia and a Japanese pharmaceutical firm where they managed to reach clinical testing in 12 months instead of the typical 5 years. But then a year later or several years later, it was discontinued as it didn't achieve the evaluation criteria during the phase one study where lots of drugs drop out. So it's really early days. AI is supposed to make drug discovery faster and cheaper. Around 24 drugs and counting that were developed with the assistance of AI are now in or entering clinical trials. That's according to an article by MIT last year. There are a lot of AI companies making claims they can't back up. And when I was in San Francisco several years ago meeting with one AI drug discovery startup in particular, they were walking me through this. And I was quite surprised that there's so much BS out there. That's just how it is, I suppose. In silico claims, the first AI generated and AI discovered drug, which has now reached phase two clinical trials. That's according to Fierce Biotech this year. So if you're looking for the first AI discovered drug that may be commercialized, then that's certainly one candidate. But there are, as I said, 24 and counting that are entering clinical trials. But for in silico, they said with Gen AI, the company reached the first phase of clinical trials in only 2.5 years at a fraction of the cost. So I'd say after a decade of work, it's about time they started seeing some drugs that are hinting at being commercialized. And the other thing to note here within this sector is the consolidation that's likely to happen. So you see that, you know, Recursion and Exscientia potentially merging, but there's also other names that are being purchased by some of the leaders and whatnot, or even by large pharmaceuticals. Now, I don't think we really did AbCellera too much justice in today's presentation. And what I would recommend you do next is watch this video that we really dig into AbCellera's appeal and the potential risks associated with investing in that firm. Please make sure to subscribe and like this video. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this today.